Welcome, I'm Linda Medina Lopez and your host for UpCloseTV. Joining us today is Ms. Quevette Terrell, who is the Teacher of the Year for the Austin Independent School District. Yes. Congratulations, Ms. Quevette.
Thank you so much, it's such an honor.
Great, well we'd like to get to know you a little bit better, and can you share with us where you're from, okay. Where you studied, how long you've been in Austin?
Okay, mm-hmm. I grew up in San Antonio, Texas. I've been here for about 13 years. I went to the University of Texas at San Antonio. I love Austin, you know. Great food, great culture here, great vibe, everyone's healthy, everyone's running around. It's an awesome place to be.
What made you transition from San Antonio to Austin?
My sister, she went to UT and she was living here. So I decided to just come and visit her. So actually I just graduated from college, probably about 2 weeks prior. And I said, let me go visit her, see how Austin is and everything. So I was actually just gonna come and just maybe try to do some substitute work, you know, until I got a job, because it was mid-year, you know, it was back in December. So I went into HR, and they said they weren't hiring right now because they were doing some PD. So I still went in, I got on, and yeah. So
That was history.
The rest is history.
Wow, that's amazing. By chance, you just happened to be the right place at
the right time.
So tell us more about your students and who they are and what inspires you about them.
Well, because I grew up in South Side of San Antonio, so a lot of my students are the same kind of different demographics. So when I came in actually to interview at Webb, I mean, right away, that was the first question they asked me. Now, how are you going to connect with our type of kids here? And I said, well, you know what? This is the type of kid that I grew up with, you know what I mean? And the kind of area I grew up as well. So to be able to kind of give back and inspire my students is something that I've always wanted to be able to do. So, I mean, they're energetic. It's like just giving our kids just hope and promise, you know, in their communities, you know, helping them just break down kind of the barriers that they see in their lives. So I'm all about trying to inspire, motivate, and get them out there, get them exposed, get them doing things.
In their words, how would they describe Miss Terrell?
Oh, well, their words are like, oh, coach, you have swag, or, you know, that kind of stuff. But I hear a lot, you know, caring, energetic, enthusiastic, you know, motivating, and that's great. And they motivate me as well, and they inspire me as well. So it's like twofold for both of us. So it's great.
A couple of months ago, I went to the South by Southwest EDU, and I saw the Webb Middle School students performing.
My force.
Yes. So tell me more about the dance group.
Okay, force. It stands for Focusing on Reaching Children Everywhere, and I started the group about 4 years ago. And it started off with me working on this eighth grade talent show. And when I started doing that with the dancers, I decided, you know what, it would be great to continue this and get our kids around the city, get them exposed to different venues. I'm all about exposing our kids. So it kind of sparked from there. And then we went on, so we do about 10 shows a semester. We go around the city, like dancing. Also, we got into also doing like some public speaking and things like that. My sixth grade, it's a combination of my sixth, seventh, and eighth grade students. And my leaders just got promoted. And we just go around, like I said, dancing. We choreographed the stuff together. And we practiced probably about 4 days a week after school. And also we're doing their lunches. Things like that. We invite the parents, you know, over and things like that as well. So just getting them out there, getting them exposed, getting them ready. But the whole goal of them is just to expose them and to inspire people. And I put Focusing on Children Everywhere because I want them to concentrate on, like, you know, let's reach kids, you know, north, south, east, and west. What can we do, you know? And you know, eventually it would be great for me to get other members in other areas involved in our group as well.
Kind of creating some chapters within the school district.
Right.
Have you seen any type of progress within your students that are in force?
Oh my goodness, oh, so much progress. Actually, the leader of my group who just got promoted, I mean, this is the kid that came in at sixth grade, you know, almost getting involved in getting gangs, getting into fights, you know, and I got to meet him actually through that, because I already had started with one of my groups, and he kind of, I noticed he would kind of, you know, dance a little bit around, you know, around the school and stuff like that. So I invited him to be in my group, and ever since he got into the group, it's like, it was just a total change, and, you know, he totally turned around. And all of a sudden, he just started becoming a leader. He was part of the head of tutoring programs. He started leading mentoring programs and things like that. So it's a total change. He said it's all about because he got to be a leader. And that's what it's all about when I'm teaching my students. It's all about leadership.
Right, giving them the opportunity.
Empowering them, right.
Great. Yeah. So you are a physical education teacher. Mm-hmm. So what is it that you do differently in your classroom?
Empowering my students, I make them leaders. I mean, they run the class, and I'm just a facilitator, you know. So it's like from the first week of school, I start giving them those leadership roles. I get the kid that, you know, kind of, you know, the really energetic, hyper kid, maybe sometimes they know how to channel their energy in a positive way, maybe sometimes, you know, they get in trouble. You know, I make them the leaders. I get the kid that kind of flies under the radar, the kind of quiet kid. So I try to find a group of kids, and it's usually about, you know, 5 to 8 leaders that, you know, run my class, run the stretches, go through the static and dynamic stretches. And then every day I pick a teacher in the class, and they pretty much go through the objective, the activity, our think, pair, share questions, and all those kind of things. And it's something to see the transformation from like those first weeks of school down to like, let's say, when we get to like mid first semester. Because you get to where kids are just shy, don't really want to get up there. All of a sudden now where kids are running to me, coach, can I be teacher today? Can I be teacher today? And that's what I want to see. I want them to be able to just be like, okay, I can do this. I can lead this. Because that's kind of stuff that's going to transfer to them later on in their lives. You know, learning how to collaborate, learning how to be positive. So when they're the teacher, they have expectations. They have roles when they're up there. You know, everyone has to raise their hand. They all have to track the speaker when they're up there. We're all asking open-ended questions. We're doing our think, pair, share. We're all using our academic vocabulary when we're in the class. So it's all these things that we want our kids to transfer on when they get on, you know, as they get older, to be able to transfer on what they've learned in school. So
you have this passion.
Right.
So what drives you to do what you do? What's the secret?
Gosh, I know. let me see. Skittles? No. It's my mom and it's my sister growing up. My mom always just had the thing about when we were kids, just, you know, you could never use board in my house growing up. You just didn't do it. There's just too many things for you to do. You could never sleep in my house. We're always in the library. We're always getting up and doing something. And, you know, we didn't have a lot of money growing up. So me and my brother would get up. I have a twin brother, Detrick, love him to death. But anyway, so we would get up early in the morning. We'd go collect cans with we had this plastic giraffe. It was like a scooter. And we'd get on our tire jump rope to our bicycles and the scooter, I mean, to the sled. And we would, you know, ride our bicycles collecting cans. Or we started, like, cutting yards for, like, $10, you know, front and back. And, you know, thinking about it now, those people were getting a steal, you know. But it was just different things where mom instilled always, you know, you want something, you got to go out there and work for it. They're not going to just give it to you. And it's those kind of things. And having clean fun. And she used to always tell us growing up, like, you know, idle brain is the devil's workshop. Be doing something, get involved in something, you know, and be someone, and don't let anyone tell you that you can't do something. And those kind of, those same principles my mom instilled into my brother and I, the same influence and the same kind of things I give to my students as well. You know, it's those nuggets that mom gave me growing up that I'll forever have that I could transfer onto my students. And always to, you know, doing things for others and never concentrating on what you don't have. And like I said, the fact that we didn't have a lot of money, I remember mom taking us to like Chuck E. Cheese, and we didn't have money to, you know, buy the pizza or, you know, get on the rides. But so sometimes we bring in sandwiches and we would be like, we go playing the balls all day. But it's just things like that where we never knew where kids that were struggling, because she always made everything okay. And it's that kind of mindset where you never felt sorry for where you were or what you were around. It was all about, you know, you finding the hope and you finding the positive, you finding the light at the end of the tunnel, and you making those opportunities for yourself. And, you know, being great, you know, is always should be the expectation, not the exception, you know. Never make an excuse, you know, not to be the best that you can be every single day. And like I tell my students, you know, when you leave somewhere, it's a better place because you existed, because you were there, you know. And don't just show up, you know, show out when you get there. What I mean by show out doesn't mean like, you know, act up. I mean show out as in like you doing your best, giving 110%. You know, you giving that energy and that motivation, because I think there's something inside of every student. There's potential and hope inside of all of our kids, just like all of our teachers. And all what teachers do, the great thing is we use this platform to go and ignite that power and ignite that hope. And that's something that I want our teachers that we do, and that's something that I want our students to see, and also for them to be like, okay, I can do this. It's an amazing thing when that light finally turns on for our students. And sometimes it happens when they're in class and they're, you know, they're doing their math and they finally get it, or they're, you know, their science, or even in PE, they're doing something kinesthetically and they finally figure out how to do something. It's amazing what happens. So it's those kind of things where you want them to see those successes they have, to be able to transfer it on to their lives as they get older, to be like, okay, I can do this and I am a leader. It doesn't matter where you start in life, it's where you finish. And that is my tagline, you know, with my students all the time. I don't care where you start, it doesn't matter where you grow up. You use all the situations in your life to go and push you, to propel you to be great. And that's what I think. I think everyone has greatness inside of them. And everyone has, but it's all about just being motivated to do it and pushing you. And with this, it's been great because a lot of teachers have been coming up to me lately saying, I want to start this program, coach, but I'm not really sure. I'm just kind of waiting to get motivated, you know. And I'm like telling them, like, don't ever wait for motivation. You start doing something, I guarantee you're going to get motivated. Okay. I sat on the mentoring program I started about 5 years ago for like about a year and a half. I would lose sleep over it. I'd get up, I'd write something down like, no, and I would be like, I don't have the time. I can't, you know, what if it doesn't work, or what if this and what if that? And I think that finally, just one day, I decided you just got to just do it. And so my message to my students is always, you know, and people is just, you just got to just do it. You just got to just start. And if you're doing what's best for kids, you're going to be successful. And there's so many great people out there and have great colleagues within, you know, my web family. And we all, you know, everyone wants to do something. So it's great when you have people that are visionaries that, you know, want to delegate or, you know, help out and work collaboratively. And it's something that I think what makes success, you know, teamwork makes the dream work truly. And it's something that takes, you know, it takes a campus, it takes a village, like we say, it takes a lot.
So what kind of advice would you give to other teachers across the school district that are wanting to, you know, do some of these creative initiatives like right. you have with Fours and the mm-hmm. mentorship program?
To start it, you know, like I said, I mean, I talk to a lot of my colleagues and they have great ideas, but it's just sometimes just finding the time to do it. And it's just about working with the other teachers as well. When I started the mentoring program, I remember I said, okay, we'll have a meeting once a week and we'll do all this. And I realized is that, you know, time is limited. So I had to find ways, creative ways, like, okay, how can I get it? So with the mentoring program, I started to think where the requirement is you meet with kids 30 minutes once a week. So it's something that, okay, that's obtainable. And all of a sudden you start seeing it grows because now all of a sudden now you're working with that kid two or three times a week and after school and before school. So I'll just tell them, you know, just start something, you know, just start it, you know, have a little plan and like, okay, maybe just once a week we'll meet here doing this. And then I guarantee you it's gonna grow from there. And so I'll tell my message would be, you know, just start it. And also too, have the mindset of just outside of just your classroom. After Salute, I got to talk to a couple of my teachers and one in particular. And we were talking and he was telling me something about, you know, just concentrate mainly on just science, you know. That's what I thought, okay, I'm just a science teacher. But I'm learning that it's bigger than that, you know. Everyone, like I said, everyone has a platform as an educator. But what are you going to do with your platform? You know, every day you go to work, you have a responsibility to our kids. And what are you going to give to our kids? So the fact that you have this awesome platform and you're able to reach these kids and they're impressionable, you know, what are you going to give to them? What are you going to show them? So we take it outside of our classroom where the science teacher is now working with the language arts teacher. We're working collaboratively or we're starting programs together or, you know, being part of my mentoring program, I have pretty much like it's pretty much all my faculty on board with my mentoring program where they're mentoring at least one or two students. And I'm able to now go and check out their classrooms, see how those students are doing in those classrooms. And then, you know, they're emailing me back. And now all of a sudden I know every student and every teacher on my campus because of the mentoring program. So like I said, I mean, I would tell them, you know, just start it. You know, and don't wait for the motivation, just do it. And we all have it inside of us. You know, we just have to just get to work, you know.
Have you tapped into any community partners or corporations or businesses to support you in your initiatives, whether the Force or the mentorship program?
Well, the great thing about it, though, is that they kind of like connect with me, you know. Mm-hmm. The fact that we've been able to dance at so many venues or locations because, you know, they're emailing me and mm-hmm. they heard about this. It'll be great if your kids can come. And then we danced at UT and there was a couple of teachers there from DISD, Dallas Independent School District, and they kind of reached out and wanting to, how do we get this started, you know, in our mm-hmm. schools and how do we get the mentoring started in our schools? So it's all about, and it's just so great because as educators and everywhere you see, people all want to do something, all want to make a difference, but how can we go and tap into our students? So I was happy to share with them and I had my kids share with them as well. And I love getting my kids out there. So when people invite me to speak at their school or come to an event, I'm taking my kids with me. And they write out speeches and they're able to talk. And it's a thing about giving them that confidence because I see them as leader every day. And it's amazing when you finally see what I've been seeing. You know, it's like, you know, giving visibility to sometimes when kids may feel invisible, you know.
Winning the District Teacher of the Year is an accomplishment. What does it mean to you?
Oh, wow. It's such an amazing honor. It means that I get to represent so many great teachers that we have in this district. You know, to be able to have that great platform to be on is something that is, it's a blessing. And it's something that I really want to, you know, work hard on doing a great job. and representing this district, representing our teachers. I feel like it's a great way to have our voices heard and to work on really trying to get some things rolling that we want to try to, you know, try to start.
What does it mean to you moving forward?
Well, like I said, a platform is really a big thing, really big thing for me, the platform that I'll be able to have. And also, too, getting really involved in, you know, what the ins and outs of what's going on in the district. Being able to just see the impact that has already happened and the impact that that hopefully that I can contribute to the district, you know, with insight that I made, that I have.
Alright, you're gonna go straight up, okay? You're gonna go straight up, you're gonna come up to
Coach Terrell. Out of all the teachers in Austin and here at Webb Middle School, Coach Terrell is Austin ISD Middle School Teacher of the Year.
Guys, amazing. Thank you so much. Such an honor. I appreciate it. Thank you so, I don't even know what to say. I'm so just floored. I really appreciate it. Appreciate my awesome staff, teachers here. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
So earlier this spring, Dr. Cruz surprised you as being the Middle School Teacher of the Year. How does that compare to the announcement of District Teacher of the Year?
Oh my gosh, yeah. I was beyond words. It was such an amazing night. It was such a magical night. It was because I was able to share with my family. You know, my family, they don't live here. And it was just great to just be able to experience that with my students and my family. It was like the best day of my life. And to go back and talk to my mom now, who just can't, every time I talk to her on the phone, she's like, she just gets so excited. She's like so elated. It's like it was the best day of my life. It was the happiest day. So to be able to get that honor and be able to thank and honor the people that helped and paved that way for me to be able to obtain such a great honor was just something for me that was just extraordinary. You know, it's even hard for me to put into words because it was like it was exploding inside.
Please, if you could just please do this for me, Mom, will you please stand? I've always wanted to pay you back for adopting these kids when you're almost 50 years old, these two twins that you believed in, that you didn't have a home and a family. And we didn't have much money, and you said if we have to eat bread and drink water, we'll eat bread and drink water together. So, Mom, you're 81 years old, and you always told me, give me my flowers while I'm living. So today I give you this bouquet and this honor of being Teacher of the Year and knowing that you inspire me so much. And the reason I'm able to give and do what I do is because you gave to me and my brother Detrick, and I appreciate you so much for that. I can never pay you back. I can just pay it forward. So that's what I'm doing tonight, Mom, and I'll continue to do with my journey in education.
Just be able to see the look on your face, and I think it's just something as kids, you know, we always want to make our parents proud of us. We always want to pay them back, I always say. And I told my mom on that night, I can never pay you back. I can only pay it forward. And that's what, this reason why, you know, with me being a teacher and trying to do what I can for my students. But in that night, it just felt kind of great for her to just kind of see a glimpse of just thank you, you know, for what you've done. And this is what, you know, you did because you believed in these two kids and adopted us. It's just something that was just amazing, you know. And it's something that after it happened, my kids, I mean, they were, for the next, you know, 2 weeks, I mean, they were just excited every day to come to class, like, Coach, so, you know. So just even to see the excitement in their eyes and just being able to see that this is what can happen when I work really hard or, you know, when I get my education and everything. So it was just really great to share that with all my loved ones, you know. And it's such a great thing that the district does to honor their teachers, you know, because there's so many great educators out there. And it's just so great to just be able to you know, share that honor with so many.
In America, a student drops out every 26 seconds. Mm-hmm. What can we as educators do to ensure that students graduate from high school and are ready for their lives?
I think there's some great things going on in this district, especially at, you know, at Reagan and LBJ with the early college. I think it's a way to motivate the kids in our community, get them that college credit early, save a lot of money, but also kind of give them, like, you know what, I can do this, kind of give them that inspiration. You know, graduate with the associates, they're gonna save a lot of money, first of all, which is awesome. Parents will be happy about that, but also too, kind of get them in the mindset of like, hey, well, this is what it's like, because sometimes it's intimidating sometimes, and there's other, you know, reasons why they're not feeling like they could be able to achieve that. I think also exposing the kids earlier to universities. I was talking to someone earlier about it would be great if we can do, you know, more field trips and more bringing in, you know, college professors, college kids into elementary, middle schools to get our kids exposed early. I know when I was in high school, I think I was hearing about college from my counselors my junior year in high school. Now, granted, you know, my sister went to UT and my mom, she would talk to me about going to school early on, but imagine those kids that kind of wait until high school to be hearing about college or what school you want to go to. I feel like that's too late. I feel like it's something in elementary school, we got to already have a mindset of like getting ideas about, okay, what do I want to do? What does college consist of? You know, what does that look like for me and envisioning those kind of things? And we could talk about it, but also too, we need to expose our kids to it. You know, I think they should go on college field trips when they're in, you know, third and fourth grade, you know, give them t-shirts and give them something to get motivated about. You know, my fourth this year, I took them to a UT step show and they saw all these fraternities and sororities, you know, dancing around. They're like, oh, coach, I want to go to school. I want, and but it's something that hooked them. Okay, that's great, because also when you get involved in those fraternities and sororities, those organizations do positive things. So it's all about exposing our kids earlier on. So I feel like if we want to get our kids activated faster and doing more, we got to expose them more. And it's not just sitting around talking about it. We actually got to go and do it, expose them to those things. But early on, though, early on, and tap into what they want to do. Also, too, we're bringing in visitors for the professions they want to do, actually getting them hands-on experience. If you want to go into, you know, being a lawyer, you want to be a doctor, you want to be a dentist, let them see that. Let them see, okay, someone that looks like me that's doing the job. Okay, could I do something like this? And giving them that information. You want to go into finance. Let's bring in those professionals inside the schools and let kids hear it, let kids see it, let kids actually go and feel what that's like. And that's what's going to go and hook them, because they don't really believe it sometimes, I feel like, all the time, if they're not exposed to it and see it all the time. And the kids that I have early on in my career that I was able to work with out in Westlake, that was the thing about it. It was just the kids were in the second and third grade, and they were like, you know, I don't know what college I want to go. I already know what I want to do. And it's because it's just a lot of that's what they were immersed in. So it's about immersing our kids to these opportunities and finding creative ways to hook our kids and to get them there. Because, you know, it's an amazing thing, the opportunities and the doors that open up when you get your education. And it gives you hope, you know, when there's creative ways, and our kids have so much, you know, and at 12 years old, you know, I tell my kids sometimes, you know, at the beginning, sometimes you see where they're, we know when kids are checked out, you're thinking like, you know, you got to find a way to check these kids back in and to feel motivated and find that, you know, what, college is a great thing, or, you know, school, getting them education. And I don't know, it's just so exciting to see the transformation a lot of the students that I get to work with. And that they're exposed, and sometimes they tell me about their great teachers they have in their classes. So it's just all of us working together to try to find those creative opportunities for our students.
So it's summertime, and yeah. I appreciate that you're here in your summer. Where would you like to go on your ideal vacation?
Well, I want to finish the United States first. I mean, it would be great to go cross country, riding with my friends. That would be awesome. And also, too, probably spending some time and maybe, like, doing, like, London will be great. I mean, there's so many places I think about going, but I think about financially, too. But but ideally, though, I mean, like, you know, it's a beautiful country, you know, and it's like I would love to just, you know, finish up and just do some things in, you know, different mm-hmm. places around here and stuff.
So during the school year, where can you be found? Depends kind of on, things are you interested in?
It depends on what time of year it is, though. If it's mm-hmm. if it's around October area, we're doing stuff and working on the mentoring stuff, or we're working on the dance stuff. We're hitting like December through May. Also, I coach track at the middle school, so you'll find me at track practice. And I have some of my kids, actually, they're my fourth kids that are my managers, and I'm doing that. But it's always doing something. I work on acting too, you know, throughout. So it's different things I try to get involved and exposed to, you know.
Do you have a favorite school memory growing up?
Gosh, favorite school memory. Let's see. Oh gosh, I mean, that's kind of something I'm trying to think.
Elementary, of middle school.
Elementary. Let me see. I'm trying to think of when's the best time. Probably. Elementary school. I was the fastest kid in my elementary, middle, and high school. You know what I mean? So, field day was like a big thing for me. So this one field day, of course, I swept. I got first place in everything. My family was there. I mean, that would probably be one of the best memories in elementary school. Middle school, I was voted most funniest, crazy enough. So they had like this big little function for that whole thing. So that was kind of exciting.
What about high school, since we're on that path?
High school, it will probably be sports. I played basketball, like softball, track, cross country. But my greatest high school memory would probably be softball. At a softball game, I got player of the week. So, you know, ball gets hit, you know, deep left field, I'm running out for it. It's just like the movies, right? You run out for it, you jump, you know, you go and catch it and you fall and everything. And I get up and throw the ball down to like first base. So do like a double play. And I got player of the week in the paper. So, I mean, that was like kind of like, oh, that was really cool. But I don't know, I have a lot of memories. It'd be mostly, you know, with my friends and just the experience I had would just be playing sports and finding success in that. And I got to coach high school basketball here at Reagan High School for 6.5 years, and that was an amazing experience for me. So just getting to do that again and just getting the nostalgic feeling of like what it was like when I played sports and getting to coach, you know, kids now has just been amazing. So
what kind of message would you like to give our parents?
To continue, you know, doing what you're doing, encouraging your kids, you know, continue pushing the value of them getting an education. To spending that quality time with them, with getting down there, you know, helping them with their homework or, you know, helping them or reading to one another, you know, that I think time is the greatest thing you can just give anyone. And I think it's just something that sometimes you don't have a lot of, you know, as parents, you know, working in a lot, but spending time and valuable time with your kids and being as many functions as you can with your kids. And it just would be just continue to just be a support system for them, you know. I think I would give to them.
Great. Yeah. Is there anything else you'd like to add?
I think I've said a lot. No. Just the fact, just for us to continually work together in this district. Like it's a great place to be in AISD. It's such a large district. I was saying this earlier. You know, it's probably one of the biggest school districts. And it has so many great things that are going on here. So just continually for us to all just continue, you know, working together, finding creative ways to reach our students, and also great ways to go and give rewards to our teachers, you know, and you know, just keep on working hard, you know, pushing forward to make this, you know, a successful, you know, school district.
Thank you, Quevette, for sharing your day with us. It was a pleasure having you.
Thank you for having me.
Of course. If you have questions or suggestions for future programming, please email me at linda.medina@austinisd.org or call 512-414-9706. I'm Linda Medina Lopez and your host for Up Close TV.